Hello everyone, myself Dr. M. Srujan Kumar. My education background is pharmacy. We have been dealing with a topic called as WHO guidelines for assessment of herbal drugs from past two sessions. In order to understand this current session, please go through my past two sessions which are uploaded into my YouTube channel. Let's move on to the topic. In the last two sessions, we have completed assessment parameters like powder fineness and seed size, general advice on sampling, determination of foreign matter, microscopic and microscopic examination, thin layer chromatography, determination of ash content, determination of extractable matter, determination of water and volatile matter, determination of volatile oils, determination of bitterness value, determination of hemolytic activity, determination of tannins, determination of swelling index. Now this per current session we are going to discuss about your remaining assessment parameters. Coming to the first parameter under current session, determination of foaming index. Many herbal materials contain saponins that can cause a persistent foam when an aqueous decoction is shaken. The foaming ability of an aqueous decoction of herbal materials and their extract is measured in terms of a foaming index. What do you mean by this? Any herbal material you take, it will contain n number of phytochemical constituents. Out of this, saponin is the one which will cause a persistent foam when aqueous decoction is shaken. It is important to measure the foaming ability of an aqueous decoction or herbal materials. How the foaming ability will be measured? Based upon a foaming index. So what is the procedure involved in the determination of foaming index? Let us see. Reduce about 1 gram of herbal material to a coarse powder, sieve size number 1250, weigh accurately and transfer to a 500 ml conical flask containing 100 ml of boiling water. Maintain at moderate boiling for 30 minutes. Cool and filter into 100 ml volumetric flask and add sufficient water through the filter to dilute to volume. So what are the two steps talking about? So first, what you need to do, you need to take 1 gram of herbal material. When you say 1 gram of herbal material, that 1 gram of herbal material should be converted to a coarse powder. So how can you say that powder is coarse or finer? Based upon the sieve size number. So as you are passing through sieve size number 1250 as mentioned here, so it is a coarse powder. After that, you need to weigh 1 gram and that particular 1 gram should be transferred to a conical flask which is having a capacity of 500 ml, okay, and to that you need to add 100 ml of boiling water. Okay, after adding 100 ml of boiling water, you need to subject this conical flask for moderate boiling for the time of 30 minutes. Okay, after moderate boiling for 30 minutes, you need to cool it and you need to filter it, and this filtered content should be transferred to a 100 ml volumetric flask and add some sufficient water through the filter to dilute to the required volume. Now, next step, pour the decoction into 10 stopper test tubes, which is having a measurement of 16 centimeters height and 16 mm diameter in successive portion of 1 ml, 2 ml, 3 ml, etc. up to 10 ml and adjust the volume of liquid in each tube with water to 10 ml. Stopper the tubes and shake them in a lengthwise motion for 15 seconds, 2 shakes per second. So after these two steps, what is the third step and fourth step is talking about? So you need to take 10 stopper test tubes, and here the measurements of the test tubes have been given, 16 centimeters height and 16 mm diameter. After taking that, so you need to go for adding your successive portions. So first test tube 1 ml, second test tube 2 ml, third test tube 3 ml, 4th 4 ml, 5th 5 ml, 6th thereby till you are 10 ml. After adding successive portions into each and every test tube, now you need to make up the volume for each test tube to 10 ml. For example, in first test tube you have added 1 ml. So make up the volume, that means that remaining 9 ml should be added to make up to 10 ml. All the test tubes should have a volume of 10 ml. Okay, after that you need to stopper the test tubes and you need to shake them in lengthwise, okay, for 15 seconds. Okay, every second, two shakes should be done. Okay, two shakes per second in such a way the test tube should be shaken. Okay. What is the next step here? Allowed to stand for 15 minutes and measure the height of the foam. The results are assessed as follows. So what you need to do after shaking for 15 seconds, you need to keep it aside for 15 minutes and you need to measure the height of the foam. Okay. These particular results are assessed as following formula 1000 by small a. Okay, what is small a here? The volume in ml of a decoction used for preparing the dilution in the tube where foaming to a height of 1 cm is absorbed. As you can observe in the previous slide that we have dropped successive portions of your decoctions in each and every test tube. Okay, what is the volume in ml of the decoction used? Okay, for preparing the dilution in a tube where foaming to a height of 1 cm is absorbed. Now you need to observe each test tube. What is the test tube where the foaming height of 1 cm has been attained? Okay, and what is the volume in ml of the decoction added to that particular test tube will give you the determination of your foaming index. Coming to the determination of pesticide residues. Pesticide residues, these are the common type of residues where it will get added to your herbal material. It is very important to determine the pesticide residue. So how you are going to determine pesticide residue? Here chromatography is a recommended principle for the determination of your pesticide residue. The two type of chromatography principles are there. One is column chromatographic principle, the other one is gas chromatographic principle. Okay, sometimes if these particular chromatographic principles or techniques are not efficient enough to determine your pesticide residues, you can also adopt some other alternative methods also. Adopting means nothing but coupling your present principle with your alternative one. Okay, it can be coupled with mass spectroscopy. Okay, your column chromatography can be coupled with a mass spectroscopy. Now, after that, what you are going to do? Samples are extracted by a standard procedure. You need to extract the samples by a standard procedure. After extraction, impurities are removed by partition and or adsorption. The first primary step is to remove the impurities. That can be removed by either partition and or adsorption. And the presence of moderately broad spectrum of pesticides is measured in a single determination. And if you observe any sort of moderately broad spectrum pesticides, that should be measured in a single determination. However, these techniques are not universally applicable. And whatever methods or techniques that we have quoted here, like column chromatography or your gas chromatography or your mass spectroscopy coupled with your column or gas chromatography. So whatever techniques these are that are not universally applicable for all the types of pesticides residue to be determined. So some pesticides are satisfactorily carried through the extraction and cleanup procedures. Others are recovered with a poor yield and some are lost entirely. So our motto is to determine the pesticide residue. But sometimes what happens, you know, while during your extraction and all, okay, these particular pesticides will be carried through the extraction process. Okay, some pesticides will be cleaned up through your cleaning procedure. Okay, and some are recovered with a poor yield and some are lost entirely. These are the problems that arise in determination of your pesticide residue. Following chromatography, the separations may not always be complete. Pesticides may decompose or metabolize and many of the metabolic products are still known. So we say that chromatography is the best suited principle where you can go for separation, but you cannot ensure that the complete separation has been obtained here. Sometimes the separation may not be complete. Okay, the reasons are the pesticides may decompose, it may get metabolized. If they get metabolized also, the metabolic products, what are they and how they exist, what are their forms, that are still unknown now. Consequently, as a result of limitations in the analytical technique and incomplete knowledge of pesticide interactions with the environment, it is not yet possible to apply an integrated set of methods that will satisfactory in all situations. So when you see all the limitations of your any analytical techniques, when you talk about disadvantages for each and every analytical technique, okay, so by this, it's not only about your analytical technique. Analytical technique is on one side. On the other side, we have incomplete knowledge about pesticide interactions Now, just now we said a point that it will get metabolized to metabolic products. But what are that metabolic products are still unknown. Okay, that means that we don't know what is the fate of your pesticides after adhering to your herbal material. Okay, so we don't know the possible interactions of your pesticides with the environment, and considering all these things, we cannot apply an integrated set of methods, a particular method which will provide you a satisfactory results for the determination of your pesticide residues in all situations. If the pesticide to which the herbal material has been exposed is known or can be identified by suitable means, an established method for the determination of that particular pesticide residue should be employed. If you know that this particular pesticide will definitely adhere to your herbal material, okay, definitely you are ensuring that, yeah, this pesticide has been exposed to the herbal material, or your herbal material has been exposed to these particular pesticides, okay, it can be identified by a suitable means. When you know that, then you can adopt an established method for the determination of particular residue. So that is, there are some established methods given in WHO guidelines. Number one, determination of total chlorine and phosphorus. Next method is qualitative and quantitative determination of organochlorine pesticides. Next, analysis of esters of organophosphorus compounds. Determination of specific pesticide residue in herbal materials. Determination of desmitrin, prometrin and simazine residues. Okay, these are the some of the established methods that are already adopted by WHO guidelines. Coming to the next parameter, determination of arsenic and toxic metals. So, preliminary methods which are employed for the determination of arsenic and toxic metals are limit test for arsenic, limit test for cadmium and lead, limit test for total toxic metals as lead in extracts. Okay, these are some of the preliminary limit tests. And determination of specific toxic metals can be determined with the help of an instrument called as atomic absorption spectrometry. This particular instrument will be used for the determination of amount or concentration of specific heavy metals. Coming to the construction of this instrument, this instrument usually consists of a light source, a sample atomizer to atomize the sample, which is the basic principle involved in atomic absorption spectrometry, a spectroscope, a photometer, and a recording system to record the readings. This will constitute your atomic absorption spectrometry, and this atomic absorption spectrometry is used in the detection of specific toxic metals like cadmium, copper, iron, lead, nickel, zinc, arsenic, and mercury. And this atomic absorption spectrometry is the most reliable method, and the results are reproducible, and it is the most accurate method. Okay. Next, coming to the next parameter, determination of microorganisms. So, microorganisms can be determined by two methods. One is total viable aerobic count. The total viable aerobic count of an herbal material being examined is determined as specified in the test procedure below using one of the following methods. Okay, there are three methods in order to determine your total viable aerobic count. One is membrane filtration method. The second one is plate count or serial dilution method. The third one is aerobic bacteria and fungi aerobic bacteria and fungi method are determined by total viable aerobic count method. Next is test for specific microorganisms. Microbial test should be applied to starting plant material, intermediate and finished product wherever necessary. So any herbal plant material that you have selected for the preparation of your herbal extract, so you need to test for microorganisms, especially microbial tests are performed. So in which points this microbial test should be performed? It should be performed for starting plant material if it is necessary, or you can go for intermediate, and you can also go for finished product wherever it is necessary. So enterobacteria and certain other gram negative bacteria such as Escherichia coli, Salmonella and Staphylococcus aureus are included as target strains of the test. In order to consider this microbial test, there are some target strains of the test are present. Three target strains of the test are there. One is Escherichia coli, second one is Salmonella, and the third one is Staphylococcus aureus. Coming to the next parameter, determination of aflatoxins. Determination of aflatoxins. First, let us understand what do you mean by aflatoxins. Aflatoxins are a family of toxins produced by certain fungi that are found on agricultural crops such as maize, peanuts, cottonseed and tree nuts. What are these aflatoxins? Are nothing but toxins. From where these aflatoxins are produced? From fungi. And where these fungi present? Fungi present on the agricultural crops like maize, peanuts, cottonseed and tree nuts. The main fungi that produce aflatoxins are Aspergillus flavus and Aspergillus parasiticus. What is the main fungi that produces your aflatoxins? One is Aspergillus flavus, the other one is Aspergillus parasiticus. Where these are abundant? These are abundant in warm and humid regions of the world. These are abundant in warm and humid regions of the world. These tests are designed to detect the possible presence of aflatoxins. Okay, when you go for determination of aflatoxins, what you will detect for? You will detect for presence of aflatoxins like B1, B2, G1 and G2, which are highly toxic contaminants in any material of the plant origin. You will test for B1, B2, G1 and G2. Okay, and these particular four aflatoxins are highly toxic contaminants. Okay, which may arise in any plant material. Okay. The method does not require the use of toxic solvents such as chloroform and dichloromethane. Here in this particular method, you will not be using any sort of toxic solvents like chloroform and dichloromethane. Now we have come to a conclusion that aflatoxin determination will not be done with the toxic solvents like your chloroform and dichloromethane. In what way these aflatoxins will be determined? It will be determined with an instrument called as high performance liquid chromatography, and this particular high performance liquid chromatography will be having a column called as multifunctional column, which contains lipophilic and charged active sites, and this HPLC runs with a detector called as fluorescence detector, which helps in the detection of your aflatoxins like B1, B2, G1 and G2. This is your determination of aflatoxins. Coming to the next, radioactive contamination. Following a severe nuclear accident, the environment may be contaminated with airborne radioactive materials. As an instance, assume that your earth has been met with a nuclear accident. Now, what happens immediately after the nuclear accident? Whatever radioactive materials are there, okay, it will just enter into your earth core. Okay, and it will behave as an airborne radioactive materials in the environment. Now your environment is rich with your airborne radioactive materials following after a nuclear incident. Okay, this may deposit on the leaves of the medicinal plants. When you say it is in the environment as an airborne radioactive materials, okay, that means that this particular radioactive materials may get deposited on the leaves of your medicinal plant. Their activity concentration and the type of radioactive contamination can be measured by radiation monitoring laboratories. Okay, the concentration of your radioactive material deposited on the leaves and their type of radioactive contamination, okay, can be measured with the help of radiation monitoring laboratories of most of the WHO member states. Okay, so monitoring radiation laboratories or radiation monitoring laboratories are the laboratories which will measure your activity concentration and type of radioactive contamination. The activity concentration of radioisotopes in herbs should be assessed by the competent national radiohygiene laboratories. Coming to the activity concentration of your radioisotopes, okay, that are present in a plant material, in a herb material, should be assessed by the competent national radiohygiene laboratories. These are the laboratories to determine the concentration of your radioisotopes in your herbs. Okay, and there are some other international organizations which help you to determine the concentration of your radioactive isotopes or your radioactive materials that are present in the plants are Codex Alimentarius, Codex Alimentarius, International Atomic Energy Agency, International Atomic Energy Agency, Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, Food and Agriculture Organizations of the United Nations, and WHO. These are the international organizations which will produce the recommendations and which will produce the limits of your radioactive material should be present in the plants and type of radioactive material. Entire literature will be given by these international organizations, and these international organizations which will produce a guideline for this radioactive materials determination and radioactive contamination. Okay, moving on to the last parameter, culture media and strains used for microbiological assess. What are all the culture media and strains that are used for microbiological assess? Okay, whatever medias that have been enlisted in this particular slide that are more satisfactory, but you can also opt for other medias, okay, if they are having similar nutritive and selective properties of for the microorganisms to be tested. Okay, these are the following. The first one is Bade Parker agar test, brilliant green agar test, buffered sodium chloride peptone solution pH 7.0 test, buffered sodium chloride peptone solution pH 7.0 test, casein soybean digest agar, next cetrimide agar, cooked meat medium, difibrinated sheep blood agar medium 5%, it's also called as blood agar medium. Next, deoxycholate citrate agar medium. Next, enterobacteriaceae enrichment broth, also called as mosel. Kleigler's iron agar, it's also called as Kia. Lactose broth, Mac Conkey broth, Seborrheic glucose agar with antibiotics, soybean casein digest medium, tetrathionate bile brilliant green broth, triple sugar iron agar, violet red bile agar with glucose and lactose, and xylose lysine deoxycholate agar, and xylose, lysine, deoxycholate, agar. These are the list of culture medias and strains used for microbiological analysis. That's all about your today's session on WHO assessment of herbal drugs. Thank you very much. Please view, like, share, and subscribe to Pen Channel. Thank you very much.